बिस्मिल्लाह रहमान रहीम, वी आर गोइंग टू स्टडी द जेस्टेशनल ट्रोफोब्लास्टिक डिजीज लेटेस्ट गाइडलाइन विच वॉज पब्लिश्ड इन 30th September 2020, मीन्स फ्यू डेज बैक. ओके, सो दिस गाइडलाइन वॉज द गाइडलाइन नंबर 38 पब्लिश्ड इन September 2020. ओके, द डेफिनेशंस आर रिटन इन द गाइडलाइन विच आर ऑलमोस्ट द सेम as we had in the previous guideline, and the definitions are: gestational trophoblastic disease comprises a group of disorders spanning the pre-malignant condition of complete and partial molar pregnancies, also known as hydatidiform moles, through to the malignant condition of invasive mole choriocarcinoma and very rare placental site trophoblastic tumor and epithelioid trophoblastic tumor. The malignant potential of atypical placental nodules remains untapped. Okay, so if we have complete or partial mole, we have three main fields. First of all, invasive mole. Secondly, choriocarcinoma. Third is placental site trophoblastic tumor. Now come to the subdivision. Okay, molar pregnancy can be subdivided into complete and partial mole based on the genetic and histological features. Complete molar pregnancies are diploid and androgenic in origin with no evidence of the fetal tissue, whereas the complete moles are usually 75 to 80% arise as a consequence of duplication of a single sperm following fertilization of an empty ovum. And some complete moles, 20 to 25% can arise after diaspermic fertilization of an empty ovum as well. Now, partial molar pregnancies are usually 90% in 90% cases they are triploid in origin, with two sets of paternal haploid and one set of maternal haploid chromosomes. Okay, and partial molar pregnancies occurs in almost all cases following diaspermic fertilization of an ovum, and occasionally molar pregnancy represents tetraploid or mosaic conceptions. In partial mole, there is usually evidence of fetus or fetal blood cells. Not all triploid or tetraploid pregnancies are partial mole. For the diagnosis of a partial mole, there must be histological evidence of trophoblastic hyperplasia. So that is the subdivision, which is the same as we had in the previous guideline. Now, come to the point of how do molar pregnancies present to the clinicians. Okay, we have two points which are extra in this guideline. It means in previous guideline we didn't have these two main points. Okay, so how do molar pregnancies present to clinician? Clinician should be aware of the symptoms and signs of the molar pregnancy. The most common presentation is irregular vaginal bleeding, as all of you know. A positive pregnancy test and supporting ultrasonographic features. Okay, vaginal bleeding, positive pregnancy test, and ultrasonographic features of the molar pregnancy. These things are very much diagnostic. Okay, in this guideline, it's written that we need to be aware of the less common presentations as well. Less common presentation of the molar pregnancies include hyperemesis, excessive uterine enlargement, hyperthyroidism, early onset preeclampsia, and an abdominal distension due to thecal lutein cyst. Okay, these are new in this guideline. Now, very rarely women can present with hemoptysis or seizures due to metastatic diseases affecting the lung or the brain. Okay, so the new guideline tell us some different features as well: less common presentation and rare features. Okay, now how are the molar pregnancies diagnosed? About this, it's written that definitive diagnosis of molar pregnancy is made by histological examination, but removal of the molar pregnancy. What is the best method for the removal of molar pregnancy? Suction evacuation is the method for the removal of the complete and the partial molar pregnancies.
Now, something is written about ultrasound guidance as well. Ultrasound guidance during the removal and curettage may be of use to minimize the chances of perforation and to ensure that as much tissue as possible is removed. Now, section curettage is the method of choice for the removal of the partial molar pregnancies as well, except when the size of the fetal parts deter the use of the suction curettage, and then medical removal can be used. Now let us discuss NTT prophylaxis. NTT prophylaxis is recommended for the removal of a molar pregnancy.
And another question,
is it safe to prepare the cervix prior to the surgical removal? About this, it's written that preparation of the cervix immediately prior to the uterine removal is safe. Yes. Can oxytocin infusion be used during the surgical removal?
About this, is written that excessive
vaginal bleeding can be associated with surgical management of molar pregnancy, and involvement of an experienced clinician is advised. And the use of oxytocin infusion to completion of the removal is not recommended. And if the woman is experiencing significant hemorrhage prior to or during the removal, surgical removal should be expedited, and the need for oxytocin infusion weighted up against the risk of uterine embolization. Now, in what circumstances should a repeat surgical removal be indicated, and what is the timing? There is almost always a role for the urgent surgical management of the woman who is experiencing heavy or persisting vaginal bleeding, persistent vaginal bleeding causing acute hemodynamic compromise, particularly in the presence of retained pregnancy tissue on ultrasound. Okay, this is what the new guideline says. Okay, the new guideline says that there is always a role for urgent surgical management in a woman with persistent bleeding. Now, outside the context of acute compromise, there should be consultation with the relevant GTD referral center before performing surgical management for second time in the same pregnancy. So, the latest guideline tells us about the need for the second
surgical intervention.
Okay, but it also says that if the woman is not hemodynamically compromised, we shouldn't make the decision of second evacuation straight away. Now, histological examination of a tissue in the diagnosis of GTD, as we have told that definitive diagnosis is made by histological examination, should pregnancy tissue from all the miscarriages be examined histologically? Okay, the histological assessment of material obtained from medical or surgical management of all miscarriages is examination of a tissue in the diagnosis of GTD, as we have told that definitive diagnosis is made by histological examination. Should pregnancy tissue from all the miscarriages be examined histologically? Okay, the histological assessment of material obtained from medical or surgical management of all miscarriages is recommended to exclude trophoblastic neoplasia if no fetal part are identified at any stage of pregnancy. Okay, so if we can't find fetal part, it is most likely to be the GTD. Okay, so it is very important to do histological examination. Now, another thing in this guideline, the latest guideline says that the woman who receive care for miscarriage should be recommended to do urine pregnancy test 3 weeks after miscarriage. After 3 weeks of miscarriage, it's important to do UBT. Okay, now another thing, should pregnancy tissue be sent for examination after abortion? About it's written that there is no need to routinely send pregnancy tissue for histological examination following therapeutic abortion, provided that fetal parts have been identified at the time of surgical abortion or on prior ultrasound examination. The thing is same. If we find the fetal part, there is no need for histological examination. And women who undergo medical abortion should be recommended to do urine pregnancy test 3 weeks after abortion. Okay, so this point is the same for both miscarriages and abortion as per new guideline. Now, how should women with elevated HCG after possible pregnancy event be managed? Okay, elevated beta HCG after possible pregnancy even. Referral to GTD center should be considered for all women with persistently elevated HCG, either after an ectopic pregnancy has been excluded or after two consecutive treatment with a methotrexate for the pregnancy of unknown origin. Okay, this is also new in the latest guideline. Okay, means about the woman with elevated beta HCG, we have to first of all rule out ectopic pregnancy if it has been excluded and she has received two consecutive treatments for methotrexate, and even then HCG is high, then we have to refer such patient to GTD center. Okay, now which woman should be investigated for GTN after non-molar pregnancy? Any woman who develops persistent vaginal bleeding after pregnancy event is at risk of having GTN. A urine HCG should be performed in all cases of persistent or irregular vaginal bleeding lasting more than 8 weeks after pregnancy events. Okay. If a patient is still having bleeding more than 8 weeks after pregnancy event, then urine HCG test should be performed. Secondly, symptoms from metastatic disease such as dyspnea or hemoptysis or new onset seizure or paralysis can occur very rarely. Okay, the rare we have discussed the rare presentation as per new guideline, and it says that symptoms of metastatic diseases are very rare. Biopsy of the secondary deposits in the vagina can cause major hemorrhage and is not recommended. Okay, now another thing, how should suspected ectopic pregnancy in a woman be managed? Okay. Cases of women with ectopic pregnancy suspected to be molar in nature should be managed as any other case of ectopic. If there is local tissue diagnosis of the ectopic molar pregnancy, the tissue should be sent to the center with appropriate expertise for pathological review. Okay, initially we have to do the same management as we do for ectopic, but once we take out the ectopic tissue, we have to send it for pathological examination. Now, how is twin pregnancy of a viable fetus with presumptive coexisting molar pregnancy be managed? Okay, sometimes there is a viable fetus, but there is a twin pregnancy and the second twin is considered to be or suspected to be molar. How can we manage such case? Okay, about this, it's written that woman diagnosed with combined molar pregnancy and viable twin, or where there is diagnostic doubt, should be referred to a regional fetal medicine center and GTD center. Okay, so to these women, we have to tell that we need to refer you to the specialist center. Okay. Next, it's written that in the situation of a twin pregnancy, where there is one viable fetus and other pregnancy is molar, the woman should be counseled about potential increased risk of perinatal morbidity and the outcome for GTN. Okay, we have to do proper counseling that there is increased risk of perinatal morbidity and outcome for GTN. Now, prenatal invasive testing for the fetal karyotype should be considered in the cases where it is unclear if the pregnancy is complete mole with a coexisting normal twin or possible singleton partial molar pregnancy. Prenatal invasive testing for fetal karyotype should be considered in the cases of abnormal placenta such as mesenchymal hyperplasia of the placenta. Okay, so the main thing which we have to do is first of all refer to the specialist center, secondly counseling of the woman about the risk, and thirdly counseling about the need for fetal karyotype and prenatal invasive testing as well. For prenatal invasive testing for fetal karyotyping basically. Now, another thing, how should a placental side trophoblastic tumor or epithelial trophoblastic tumor be managed? All the women with a placental side trophoblastic tumor or epithelial trophoblastic tumor should be registered with and cared for with GTD center. Okay, now how should a placental nodule or atypical placental nodule be managed? Now about this is written that women with atypical placental side nodule or where the local pathology is unclear should have histology reviewed centrally. And all the women with the atypical placental side nodule will be called up for central review to discuss the existing data, perform staging investigation, and to determine further management. Women with a typical placental side nodule do not currently require further investigation on the review. Now, which woman should be registered at GTD center? Okay, we discussed that we have to refer few women to the GTD center. So which woman should be referred? All women diagnosed with GTD should be provided with a written information about the condition and the need for referral for follow-up by the GTD center. That should be explained. Okay, another thing is that clinician should be aware that the outcome for the woman with the GTN or GTD are better with the ongoing care from the GTD centers. The registration of affected woman with GTD center represents a minimum standard of care. Now, another thing is that women with the following diagnosis should be registered and require follow-up as determined by the screening center. Okay, complete molar pregnancy, partial molar pregnancy, twin pregnancy with a complete or partial molar pregnancy, limited macroscopic or microscopic molar change suggesting possible early complete or the partial molar pregnancy of the choriocarcinoma, placental side trophoblastic tumor. Or epithelial trophoblastic tumor and atypical placental side nodule. Okay, so these are something new in this guideline, atypical placental side nodule. Now, what is the optimum follow-up following a diagnosis of GTD? Okay, for a complete molar pregnancy, if HCG has reverted to the normal within 56 days of the pregnancy event, then follow-up will be 6 months from the date of uterine removal. Okay, this is the same as we studied in the previous guideline. If HCG has not reverted to the normal within 56 days of pregnancy event, then follow-up will be 6 months from the normalization of the HCG. Now, the new thing in this guideline is follow-up for the partial molar pregnancy is concluded once HCG has returned to the normal on two samples at least 4 weeks apart. Okay, HCG has come to normal, but we have to do another sample as well 4 weeks apart. If both are normal, then she can be discharged from follow-up. Okay, but women who have not received chemotherapy no longer need to have HCG measured after any subsequent pregnancy event. Okay, now another thing, what is optimum treatment for GTN? Women with GTN may be treated with a single or multi-agent chemotherapy. Treatment is based on the FIGO 2000 scoring system for GTN following assessment at treatment center. Okay, so there is a modified 2000 FIGO scoring system which we have to use for scoring. Now, placental side trophoblastic tumor and epithelial trophoblastic tumors are now recognized as variant of GTN, and they may be triggered with the surgery because they are less sensitive to the chemotherapy. Now, coming to another point, that what is the recommended interval between the complete or partial molar pregnancy and trying to conceive in the future, and what is the monitoring of the woman following a successful pregnancy after previous molar pregnancy, and what is the outcome of subsequent pregnancy? Okay, so means a woman is planning to have pregnancy, so what is the proper decision about her? Women are advised not to conceive until their follow-up is complete, and women who have undergone chemotherapy are advised not to conceive for 1 year after completion of the treatment as precautionary measures. Women who have pregnancy following a previous molar pregnancy who has not required treatment for GTN do not need to send post-pregnancy HCG sample. Okay, that is very important. Now, histological examination of the placental tissue from any normal pregnancy after molar pregnancy is not indicated. In every case, we do not need to do the placental tissue examination. Okay. Now, what is the long-term follow-up of women with the GTN? The outlook for women treated for GTN is generally excellent, with the overall cure rate close to the 100%. And further pregnancies are achieved in approximately 80% of the women following treatment for GTN, either with a methotrexate alone or with a multi-agent chemotherapy. That depends upon the FICO scoring. There is increased risk of premature menopause for a woman treated with a combination of combination agent therapy. Okay. Multi-agent chemotherapy, if the woman gets that, there is increased chance of menopause. Women, especially those approaching the age 40, should be warned of the potential negative impact on fertility, particularly when treated with a high-dose chemotherapy. Now, is hormone replacement therapy safe for a woman to use after GTN, GTD? Hormone replacement therapy may be used once HCG have returned to the normal. Now, impact of diagnosis on the woman and their family. GTD centers now provide individualized support to the woman and their family throughout their GTD journey. Through dedicated GTD nurse specialists and advisors who can be accessed either through the attending a GTD centers via phone or both. Online support groups are available alongside regular drop-in support groups. Okay, in the different hospital in the UK. Okay, so that is all about the GTD guideline.